Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Recon, A Fight to the Death, by Rick Partlow, narrated by Kyle McCarley. Chapter 1. I jumped into the darkness between the buildings without a thought, knowing that if he could make it, then I could too. 2 meters of empty space felt like the Grand Canyon to me, but I was airborne for less than 2 seconds. Corrugated aluminum vibrated beneath the soles of my boots as I impacted the gentle slope of the tenement's roof, scrambling forward a step to keep my feet before I started running again. The guy I was chasing was only about 10 meters ahead of me, over the slight rise in the center of the roof, and about to jump to the next in the line of 3-story row houses that were jammed together on this street. I didn't know his name, but I knew he could run. He was tall and skinny, with long legs that ate up the meters, and dark, loose clothing that seemed to flap in the breeze like raven's wings when he made the leap to the next rooftop. From up here, I could see the gentle, muted lights of Sanctuary just a few kilometers away, stark in its contrast with the harsh glares and deep shadows of Overtown. The sudden flares of security floodlights and cheap neon from the bars and brothels scattered between the apartment blocks made it hard to make out details in the darkness, even with the enhanced optics of my contact lens. I held my breath as I jumped again, following the man in black without being able to see where I was going to land. This time, it was bare, gnarled build foam shaped into a dome, which meant this had been one of the first buildings constructed for the refugees from the occupied colonies during the war. Those were all simple, unadorned pours of raw build foam from automated dispensers, though in the years since they'd been covered up by cheap, colorful plastics in a vain attempt to make a silk purse out of a sow's ear. Others had filled in the gaps gradually, unauthorized and unregulated, slapped together from aluminum and plastic scraps and wood taken illegally from the surrounding forests. No one had bothered to stop them because there'd been a war on, and they were refugees, and people had felt bad for them. When the war had ended, most found themselves without a home to go back to, so Overtown had stayed and grown, and had attracted gangs and drugs and crime like a rotting corpse drew in scavengers. At some point, it had become impossible to fix. To deal with it would have required an expenditure of goodwill and political capital in quantities that no local politician had been willing to pay, so far. The constabulary on Hermes didn't even patrol the place. As long as the violence didn't spill out into Sanctuary or any of the other cities on the planet, no one cared. That's what made it a good place to hide out when you were wanted in connection with a murder investigation, like this guy was. The cops wouldn't chase him in Overtown, but I wasn't a cop. Another rooftop, and I cursed as my shin smashed through a handmade wooden railing, sending me tumbling forward into a clumsy shoulder roll. I pushed myself back to my feet and froze for a moment as I realized that there was someone sitting just a meter away. It was a child, dressed in worn and ragged clothing that had probably been fabricated in Sanctuary and given away by some charity. She was maybe 11 or 12, with long, dark hair in dirty, twisted dreadlocks, and she stared at me with eyes wide and white with fear. I wanted to tell her that I wasn't going to hurt her, that she didn't have to be afraid. But I didn't have time, so I did the next best thing and got the hell away from her. My right leg was throbbing, and I was lucky I hadn't broken it. But I limped to the other end of the roof as quickly as I could, trying to spot the guy. There he was, on the next building over, glancing around like he was looking for something, like maybe a way down. I kicked through the railing on that side, feeling the brittle, dry crunch of it through my boot, then backed up far enough to get a running start. The target was looking back at me now, hearing the sound of the breaking wood, and I could see him take off for the next housetop. I threw myself across the gap, nearly 3 meters this time, and barely caught the edge with the toe of my lead boot. I felt myself starting to slip off and lurched forward, desperately trying to get my center of gravity over solid rooftop. The spiked soles of my boot dug into the asphalt shingles someone had laid down over the wood there, and I scraped my gloved fingertips across it until I could feel my knees touch against the rough surface. "Shit," I hissed, pulling myself up and heading back after him. I stood just in time to see him hit the next roof over, and then bust right through it and disappear from sight. I wanted to curse again, but I didn't like to repeat myself. I ignored the nagging pulses of pain still radiating from my right shin and sprinted into one last jump, trying to land off to the side of where he'd broken through. The wood was rotten on this roof, and it splintered under the soles of my boots when I hit, but I cat-footed off the weak area far enough to get my balance, then carefully made my way back to the hole the other guy had made. I reached under my jacket and pulled my pistol out of its shoulder holster, holding the weapon at low ready as I edged close enough to the opening to look down into it. Old chemical strip lighting, well past its expiration date, lined the floor of the hallway beneath the gap, casting a faint, green glow that barely illuminated enough to give the infrared filters in my contact lens something to work with. Insulation, plaster, and chunks of rotten wood from the roof still clustered in a small pile beneath the hole, surrounded by a cloud of dust that had yet to settle. But of the fugitive, there was no sign. I kept my arms tight to my side and my hands against my chest and dropped through the jagged opening, landing with a hollow, echoing thump on the cheap wood floor and falling into a crouch. I pivoted on my forward knee, pushing my pistol out in front of me as I checked both directions in the dust-shrouded hallway. Nothing. Not so much as a footprint. Damn. I couldn't just assume he'd gone to the street. If I charged downstairs, he could be waiting to ambush me. "This is Munroe," I sub-vocalized into my mastoid implant mic. "I've lost the target. Any sign of him on the insect drones?"
"Negative."
The voice had a nasal, slightly annoying accent, but I'd gotten used to it over the last couple years, especially since Vilberg had taken over our command coordination after Kane's death. He was all the way over at the Sanctuary spaceport, monitoring the drone feed from the cockpit of our ship.
"The rooftops are all clear, and I don't see him near any of the known residences."
That was the trouble with drones. Even if we'd had enough to cover all of Overtown, which we most assuredly didn't, and even if we'd had a recognition algorithm sophisticated enough to pick him up just by his facial characteristics from that far away, which we also didn't, he could just pull a hood or scarf over his face, and he'd be invisible as far as our computers knew. and there were only so many feeds one human could scan at a time.
I see him.
That was Bobby, hoarse and raspy and sounding like she had a throat full of gravel.
He's down on the street just below you, north side of the building.
Bobby, you and Sanders cut him off, I ordered, standing and running down the hall towards the stairwell. Everyone else, hold your positions. I'm heading down.
You want me and Thiongo to move up?
Another voice, higher pitched and smoother, asked me. Negative, Nemiroff, I told him impatiently. I said hold your positions, and that's what I meant. The stairs were dark and narrow, and looked like they'd split apart if you stared at them hard, but I took them three at a time anyway. I thought I heard a couple of them crack beneath my weight, but I was able to keep my balance anyway, skidding to a halt on the second floor landing. Three men sat there in the dim light, huddled into a corner, sharing hits of something illegal from a plastic pipe. The smoke was sour and smelled of chemicals, and might have been Zed or something more conventional, like ice or split. They barely reacted to my presence, and I only regarded them long enough to make sure they didn't have any weapons. I'd been to shittier places than this, and seen people do much worse things to themselves. I kept moving. The ground floor landing opened up on the building's lobby, such as it was. I guess it wasn't bad for a place thrown together in a couple weeks by refugee labor and charity volunteers with construction experience. However it had started, the intervening years had coated it with a layer of dirt and dust and smoke, and I couldn't have told you what color the walls had been originally. One of the doors on the ground floor was open, and I could hear a couple screaming at each other in Chinese inside the little apartment. Across the hall, someone laughed, maybe at the arguing couple. The outside door was propped open, and a cool breeze was coming in, drying my sweat, but carrying with it the stale smell of beer and alcohol and smoke from tobacco and marijuana, and other things less pleasant. There were half a dozen people sitting on the steps outside, sharing a bottle into plastic cups and mixing it with fruit juice, and they all looked around as I came out, my gun in my hand.
"You looking for that guy?"
one of them asked me, cocking an eyebrow. I reached into my hip pocket with my left hand and pulled out a $20 trade note, holding it out to him.
"That way,"
he told me, gesturing to the left with his cup. I handed him the bill, then took off at a jog. I was a good ways behind him now, but I wasn't worried because I wasn't alone. "Do you still have eyes on him, Bobby?" I asked, eyes scanning back and forth along the street. It was early yet, and there were a lot of people out, a lot of people gathered on the steps of their buildings. I didn't think he could get away with just heading into one of the row houses to hide out. He'd be worried they'd sell him out, like the drinker back there had done.
"Affirmative," she grunted. "He's about 20 meters ahead of me and Sanders. Want us to take him down?"
"Is he still heading for the crossroads?" I asked her. This strip of apartment buildings ended in a cross street with a row of bars, minor league casinos, and brothels, places he might think he could lose himself. He couldn't go left. That way went straight out of Overtown and put him out into the open. I didn't think he'd want to go right because the next section over was gang territory. It was a dangerous place to be at night.
"Yeah.
Then just follow. That's where we want him to go." That was where the rest of the squad was waiting. The place I'd been trying to chase him towards. Although I have to admit, I'd been trying to catch him first, just out of stubborn pride. I could see the end of the street now, shining in colored neon and harsh white. Could hear the music blaring in a dozen different songs from at least three different genres. There were people moving toward it in ones and twos and larger groups, making it hard to pick out our man. I could see Eli Sanders and Bobby Taylor just fine, though, their identification friend or foe transponders glowing like red halos in my contact lens. "I'm 20 meters behind you," I told Bobby. "Where's he at?"
25 meters at our 3 o'clock,
she responded tightly, and I knew she was having to struggle to keep him under observation in the crowd. Far enough away that he wouldn't spot me running to catch up. Not at this time of night. I stuffed my handgun back into its holster and picked up my pace, going from a steady jog to a sprint, eating up the distance between Bobby and me in a few seconds. Some of the ambling crowd heading for the entertainment strip stared at me in dull curiosity, but no one here was likely to call the cops, so I ignored them. I slowed down again to a jog when I spotted him, a black, man-shaped hole in the lights of the street ahead, and I glanced around to see that Bobby and Sanders were about even with me and maybe 10 meters to my right. My jog turned into a brisk walk. This was just how I wanted us arrayed, making sure he couldn't double back if he spotted the others. And he just might spot them. Victor and Kurt were hard to miss, at 2 meters tall and about 120 kilos of nearly identical blonde bearded muscle. The other two, well, I wasn't sure about their ability to blend into a crowd because neither had been around the team that long. I'd recruited 4 new people to replace the troops we'd lost a couple years ago, both on Pebowan and then on some unnamed, unknown rock, dozens of light years from anywhere. Then, after another couple missions, I'd had to recruit 4 more to replace those. 2 had died, and the other 2 had quit. Good help was hard to find.
"We're ready for him," Victor assured me. "We're spread out across the intersection. He's not getting past us."
I don't know what tipped him off. Maybe he'd seen one of them seeing him. Maybe it was just instinct or training or something. But the man in black went from a fast walk to a run and cut straight off to the right towards one of the few alleys that went all the way through to the next street over. The moron was heading straight into what the locals referred to as the DMZ. "Shit!" I blurted, taking off after him. The gangs might kill him, but I needed him alive. "Victor, Kurt, he's breaking to your left! Get after him!" This was bad. The reason I hadn't put any of our people down that way was because I was fairly sure they'd end up in a gunfight before they had a chance to catch our target. If we wound up having to chase him through the DMZ, there was going to be enough of a body count to draw attention. I had to get to him before it came to that. I slipped past and between and around the crowd walking up the street, hearing the scritching of my spiked soles on the gravel road and the indignant exclamations of the people I was brushing past, but mostly hearing the chuff of my own breath. I knew I was faster than this guy, because I was faster than almost anyone who wasn't artificially augmented. I'd been engineered to be faster, stronger, and smarter by a mother who could afford the best and wouldn't settle for less. But I'd given him too big of a head start, and I could tell already that I wasn't going to catch him before he made it to the next street. Maybe if I got in before the rest of them and took him down quickly, we could get out before... There was a sound that was more than a sound. A screeching, warbling, thrumming siren that went above and below what a human could hear, and then a scream that cut off abruptly just before I entered the alley. The other end of the passage between the two apartment blocks was cloaked in shadows, but the enhanced optics in my contact showed me a dark, human-shaped lump on the gravel, almost to the other end, unmoving. Standing over him was a tall, broad-shouldered figure, dressed in dark clothing, and featureless even on infrared. Something large and metallic and oddly shaped was in the man's right hand, and I made the connection with the noise I'd heard before, realizing that it was a sonic stunner. My pistol was in my hand and on its way up before he spoke, and I paused in mid-motion.
Do I have to do your job for you now, Munroe?
The big man stepped forward, and I could finally see the face that matched that rough-edged voice. Alberto Calderon had the looks of a movie star, with high, sharp cheekbones and a cleft chin, and dark eyes that Bobby described as smoldering. The looks were pure camouflage, though, because what was inside was plain ugly.
How'd you know he'd go this way?
I asked Calderon, holstering my pistol and sucking down a few deep breaths as my heart rate began to slow. Sweat was trickling down the small of my back and dripping into my eyes out of my close-cropped hair.
I didn't know,
he corrected me, tucking the sonic weapon into a pouch inside his dark brown jacket, while I fished a neural restraint web from my pocket and fastened it on the unconscious man.
But I knew where you had your people, and I knew that this was the only other place he could go.
It didn't make any sense for him to run this way,
I insisted, lifting the target up and throwing his inert form over my shoulder. He was tall, but light and skinny, and I was pretty strong for my size.
He had to know the gangs wouldn't let him get through this way.
He was desperate,
Calderon said with a sniff of disdain. His dark eyes were nearly lost in the shadows.
Desperate men do desperate things. Come on,
he said, waving at me to follow.
We need to get him back to the safe house.
I followed him with a deep sigh that I didn't make the effort to try to conceal. How the hell had I wound up working for fucking Calderon? Chapter 2. I'd been asleep when the call came through. My link was set to hibernate at that time of night, except for emergencies, or a message from Cowboy. This had been the latter. It had been received at the system's Instel Comsat by the automated message carrier, then rebroadcast to the Demeter satellite communications network, and then straight to my link. No one else could have heard it. It was encoded to my link, and, more specifically, to my implanted receiver. I sat up straight in bed at the tone sounding inside my skull and forced myself not to reach for the pistol on the nightstand table. I glanced over at Sophia and saw her still sleeping, her long, dark hair fallen over the curve of her chin, her face peaceful and content. More content than she was in waking life, I was sure. The comforter had fallen off her bare shoulder. I reached over and tucked it back in against the winter chill. Then I gave the command to play the message.
There's a job.
Cowboy was terse, jumping right in without any prologue of aw shucks bullshit this time. That wasn't like him.
You need to meet the others on Hermes, at the safe house in Sanctuary in 300 hours. Calderon will have the details. I made a sour face. Of all the revolting and distasteful aspects of working for Andre Damiani these last several years, the worst of them was the series of go-betweens that I'd had to endure since Cowboy got too busy to oversee our missions personally. First had been Divya Reddy, who'd wound up betraying us for a better offer from my mother. She'd killed Kane, our pilot, and would have handed me over for my mom's reward, but Kurt had put a bullet in her head. I hadn't thought it could get worse than that, but then Cowboy had hired Calderon. When I'd met Calderon, he'd been a company commander in the Savage Slaughter LLC security contracting firm, a mercenary. He'd been fighting for one side of a turf war between a pair of pirate world cabals on Pebowan, and hadn't been very discriminating about how many civilians his people killed in the process of doing their job. He'd lost that job shortly after, mostly due to the report I'd filed with the Commonwealth military. And then Cowboy had the brilliant idea to hire him to replace Divya, because nothing takes the place of one devious, murderous asshole like another one. 300 hours, the message had said. Given the travel time in transition space from here to Hermes, that meant I'd have to leave almost immediately. I hissed out a sigh and reached over to nudge Sophia. She blinked awake immediately, glancing around worriedly.
"What?"
she mumbled.
"Is Caesar okay?"
"He's fine," I assured her. He was almost 7 now, but sometimes he had bad dreams and knocked on the door, wanting to sleep with us. I got a message from West. Roger West was Cowboy's real name, but I never thought of him like that, because the whole time we'd served together in the war, he'd just been Cowboy.
"When do you have to go?"
The expression on her face didn't change, but I'd known her long enough to see the pain and doubt and worry. "Pretty much now," I admitted, throwing off the covers and swinging my legs out of the bed. "I'll have to pick up Victor and Kurt." They were the only two members of the team who lived here on Demeter. This was their home, and they'd been part of the civilian resistance I'd organized against the Tawny occupation during the war. So had Sophia. She was silent for a moment as I began pulling on my clothes. I could take care of personal hygiene on board ship. I'd have plenty of time for it.
"Are you going to tell your mother?"
she asked me finally, as I was fastening the straps of my boots. I felt her eyes on me and couldn't meet them. "I guess I have to," I said. "She's my only way out of this." Sophia had been there when Mom had found me finally, a couple years ago, and shown up here. She'd said we had a mutual enemy in my employer, her brother, and we needed to start working together against him before he got his hands on the predecessor technology he needed to take control of the Commonwealth government. Sophia didn't trust her, and neither did I, but I'd come to know Andre Damiani by the allies and enemies he kept, and I didn't want to be part of making him the de facto dictator of the human race.
"If you keep playing both sides,"
she warned me, her tone as flat and final as a judge's gavel,
"you're going to get yourself killed. And maybe get Caesar and I killed, too."
I winced at hearing the heart of my nightmare fears put to words.
I'd offer to leave, I said. But I don't think that would stop them. She rose from the bed, wrapping the comforter around her in the chill of the early morning, and walked over to me. She put a hand on the back of my neck and pulled me into a kiss.
You'll never leave me, and I'll never leave you,
she promised, her tone softening.
But, Munroe, if we're not going to fight, then we need to run.
As I pressed my hand to the biometric lock plate of the safe house just outside Sanctuary, I realized that I was still not running, and not really fighting yet either. It had been more than 2 years since that night when I'd agreed to work with Mom to bring down Uncle Andre, and most of what I'd done had been feeding her intelligence from the missions Cowboy had sent me on. Once or twice, she'd tasked me with sabotaging one or another of his minor operations when it wouldn't give me away, but I'd never gotten a sense of how much any of that had accomplished. When I'd complained to her once about how little we were doing, her only response was that she didn't want to burn my cover prematurely, and she was waiting for the right time. I wondered when that time would come, and whether I'd recognize it when it did. Get him in quick, I told Victor and Kurt, pushing the door open. It resisted with a heavy, metal solidity and squeaked aside reluctantly to reveal an inside as dark as the outside. The brothers dragged the motionless form of the man in black out of the utility rover parked next to the entrance, beside Calderon's personal vehicle that we'd left here several hours ago, and rushed him into the old, unadorned, one-story building that had once served as a spare parts storage facility for the algae farms out at the reservoir. It was unlikely there'd be any eyes, either natural or electronic, on us out here. But all it took was one satellite looking at the wrong place at the wrong time. Bobby walked in behind the massive, muscular brothers, a short and stocky contrast to their towering height. Her face was as solid and unadorned as the exterior of the safe house, and just as deceptive about what it hid on the inside. She was dressed in generic-looking civilian clothes, like the rest of us, to avoid attracting attention. But it seemed strange seeing her in anything except marine pattern combat armor. She looked even more annoyed than usual, maybe because Calderon had ridden back with us in our vehicle. He was walking behind her. Well, more sauntering than walking, I thought. He seemed pretty pleased about his part in tonight's operation, which had no doubt contributed to Bobby's lousy mood. The last one out of our rover was Sanders, who'd driven us here. He was a bit taller than me, and maybe a bit broader in the chest, with hair a shade blonder than mine, and a short, well-managed beard for the moment. He shaved the thing and regrew it every few months, it seemed. He glanced around behind us as he pulled the door most of the way shut, scanning the gravel road that had brought us here.
They're taking a while,
he muttered. They're just making sure we weren't followed, I reassured him. I knew he was feeling more nervous than usual about this operation because he lived in Sanctuary. Victor flipped on a light over in the far corner of the room, and his brother dumped the prisoner in a metal chair that was fastened to the floor there, with bolts sunk into the concrete. Sanders hastily pushed the front door shut against the light, walking over to a panel of monitors against the near wall and activating them with the touch of a control. They lit up with a 360-degree view of the place,
including about a kilometer down the main road that led past it, and he fell into a seat there to keep a watch. Calderon ignored all that and went straight to one of the storage bins scattered randomly around the mostly empty floor, throwing it open and pulling out the equipment to assemble a hypno-probe.
"Give me a hand with this,"
he snapped impatiently to no one in particular. I saw Bobby's facial expression and knew she was about to tell him where to stick the machinery, so I stepped in quickly to help him set it up. Not that I didn't share Bobby's feelings on the matter, but that was something that could be dealt with after the mission. "So," I prompted, as we set up the electrochemical interrogation device, "who the hell is this guy? And why do we care that he's a suspect in a murder investigation?" I spared a glance for the prisoner. He was beginning to wake up, but Victor and Kurt had strapped him into the chair before they'd pulled off the neural restraint web. He wasn't much to look at, horse-faced and pale, with a long, thin nose and hair colored a dark shade of purple in the style of the criminal element in Overtown and other colonies. He might have been old or middle-aged or young, depending on whether he'd been born into a family that could afford anti-agathic treatments and how much time he'd spent outdoors in the wind and sun. But I had developed a sense for things like that, partly due to hanging out with my mother's crowd, who defied age and tried to look like 20-somethings for all of their lives. I guessed he was in his 40s, and I was curious to see how close I'd come.
"His official record says," Calderon told me, in his oh-so-pleased-with-himself tone, "that he's Tanner McLean, a refugee from Loki who came here early in the war and amassed quite the rap sheet in that time, from vandalism to assault with intent to grand theft. It says he spent 3 years of his miserable life in work camps and most of the rest on probation. But,"
Calderon's grin was full of malice,
"his DNA profile says something different. It just happens to match exactly the profile on record for Ivan Molina, who was recruited out of Space Fleet by the Department of Security and Intelligence back during the war."
He adjusted the frame of the optical transducer and slapped McLean, or Molina, or whoever he was, across the face when he tried to resist having his head strapped into place.
"Mr. McLean is wanted for questioning," Calderon went on, "because a few months ago, several of his known associates killed a man from a corporate council mineral scout crew before the other crew member killed all four of them in self-defense."
He shrugged.
"McLean wasn't there, but the fact that he knew all four of the decedent assassins is too much of a coincidence for the local authorities. And the fact that Mr. McLean used to be Agent Molina is too big of a coincidence for us."
At the mention of the mineral scouts, I felt my blood run cold, and I tried my best not to let the fear and trepidation show on my face. The reason I'd been ready to work with my mother to bring down Andre Damiani was the discovery just a couple years ago by a mineral scout of an invaluable cache of predecessor technology on a remote, worthless rock of a planet. I'd barely been able to keep the knowledge a secret, and I'd known at the time that it wouldn't stay a secret forever.
"They're here!"
Sanders' announcement broke through my sudden fugue and shocked me back to the present. I looked over to the security monitors and saw the ground car pulling up next to the rover. Mukomo Wa Thiongo slid out from the driver's side, his dark eyes darting back and forth carefully, his hand resting on the butt of the gun holstered at his hip beneath his open jacket. His head was depilated and shined like polished ebony in the moonlight. He seemed the best of the new recruits, always keeping his cool and not running his mouth. The man getting out from the passenger side of the car, not so much. Baby-faced and perpetually wide-eyed, Alexei Nemirov was younger than me, barely old enough to have served in the tail end of the war. But he had been with the Recon Marines during the invasion of the Tawny homeworld, and I'd thought that would be qualification enough. I was beginning to wonder about that. He always seemed to need his hand held, even in the middle of an operation. That might not be a deal-breaker in a line unit when you had a lot of support and layers of command. We had one squad and not much support, and I needed independent thinkers. DeStefano and Renzer I was less certain about. Of the two, Adriana DeStefano seemed the more competent. She certainly looked dangerous, with a hard edge to her face and a hard set to her gray eyes, and I certainly trusted her more than Nemirov, but she also seemed like a follower. Peyton Renzer was a cipher, quiet and unsociable, and big enough to be intimidating, but he did his job well enough to keep it. Neither had screwed up or given me cause to get rid of them, but they felt off. I didn't have the same confidence in them that I'd had in Prouty or Waugh or O'Neill or Kane. The door banged open, and the four of them filed in quickly before Thiongo slammed it shut and nodded to me.
"We're clear," he told me. "Ran a full scan. No drones following us."
"Relax," I told them, waving to the couches arrayed against the far wall where Victor and Kurt were already stretched out. "We're gonna be here a while." By the time I'd turned back, Calderon already had the rest of the interrogation module set up around Molina like half a cage, the medical scanners surrounding him, their injectors pressed against his neck. Bobby was leaning against the wall nearby, arms folded, watching intently as our liaison touched the control to begin the process. I saw Molina tense against his restraints, his horsey face screwing up in futile resistance to the drugs that coursed through his system. If he was actually DSI deep cover, he'd have technological defenses against the drugs, but you had to start somewhere. The hypnoprobe was built to tear down defenses, one layer at a time. Finally, Molina seemed to sag into the rests of the optical transducer array, the tranquilizers taking hold. Calderon propped the man's eyelids open with a pair of electrodes that froze the muscles in place, then began to align the cups over his eyes. Once they were in place, he settled the system's headphones over Molina's ears, then checked a readout on the front of the device.
"Okay, that should do it,"
Calderon muttered, mostly to himself, I thought. "That quick?" I wondered, trying to make the question sound casual. "If he is DSI..."
"He is DSI,"
Calderon interrupted me confidently.
"But he's also assigned to Overtown. I'm sure their biggest worry for him here was the local cops. I doubt he's had his anti-interrogation wetware upgraded since the war ended. Times change. And this..."
He indicated our hypnoprobe.
"Is state of the art."
That smile again. The one I would have loved to never see again, that I wished I'd shot off his face 2 years ago.
"Here, We'll see what happens.
Calderon twisted a flexible microphone toward him from the control console.
Is your real name Melina?
Melina seemed to want to jerk away from the headphones and from the cups that held his eyes unwillingly in place. His throat muscles tightened against each other, and for a long moment I thought he might not respond to the question at all, even to lie.
Yes.
The word could have been drilled out of solid uranium with a laser for the effort it took.
Ivan Melina.
Where are you from, Ivan?
Novaya Moskva,
he insisted. It was the one stronghold of the Russian Bratva off Earth, more an idea than a physical location. It was also a place where being second best was nearly as dangerous as being first, and it didn't make any sense that someone from there would have wound up in the Marines.
Where are you really from, Melina?
Calderon pressed, just as skeptical about the answer as I was. Melina groaned, either with pain or frustration, lips quivering.
Capital city,
he admitted with a hoarse, reluctant rasp.
Earth.
That's better,
Calderon said, chuckling softly. The glow from the readouts at the rear of the hypnoprobe threw his face into a sharp relief, making his handsome features seem as diabolical as his character.
Tell me, Ivan, who do you report to? Who's your immediate superior in the DSI?
Melina tried to squeeze his eyes shut. I could tell from the way his brows wrinkled and his cheeks twitched, but the electrodes wouldn't let him, and the optical probe continued to do its work, too much for his counter-programming to handle.
Direct,
he ground out.
Director Gregorian.
My eyebrow went up, and so did Calderon's. He nodded to me with an air of satisfaction. That was unexpected. I'd met Matteo Gregorian back when he'd just been the DSI's military liaison on Inferno and working for my mother. She'd said he'd go far, even back then, and he obviously had. Why would a field agent out in Overtown report directly to the director of the DSI?
Why, Calderon demanded, would Gregorian want Edgar Martinez and Kara McIntyre dead?
My eyes narrowed. I hadn't heard the names before. Calderon hadn't shared the police report with us. I wondered which one had got killed and which one was the badass. Melina didn't answer the question, though, his face seeming to relax, as if he was relieved that he didn't have to. He doesn't know, I told Calderon, recognizing the reaction. Ask him what his mission was. The former mercenary officer frowned at me in annoyance. He didn't like being told how to do his job, particularly by me. But he leaned over the microphone and repeated the question to the prisoner.
I was told,
Melina answered through grinding teeth, the muscles of his neck spasming with a futile effort to resist.
To board their ship while the others attacked. I used a cracking module to retrieve navigational data from the ship's computer, then I erased the memory.
He paused, sucking in a breath, panting in exhaustion. Sweat was pouring off his forehead and matting his dark hair. I had the sense that he'd be lolling without the framework holding his head in place.
McIntyre, the ship's captain. She was jacked. She killed the others, but I got the data. I sent it to Gregorian in a secure burst transmission.
A corporate council mineral scout can afford physical augments? I asked, my curiosity getting the better of my trepidation. I was jacked myself, some of it thanks to Cowboy, and some on my own dime, and I knew it was really freaking expensive. The nanite repair suite Cowboy had gifted me after my first mission for him had cost more than most military cruisers, and was about as hard to obtain.
I don't know who she is or where she got it,
he admitted readily after Calderon relayed the question into his headphones.
I just did what I was told, and then kept my head down and waited for the heat to blow over.
Where is she now? I wanted to know. Calderon looked irritated at me again, probably because he'd been about to ask that himself anyway.
Don't know,
Molina said, his breathing close to normal now that we were back to questions he couldn't answer.
She left just as quick as the local cops would let her.
I felt like breathing a bit easier myself. True, Gregorian had the navigational data, and if I was right in my assumptions, then he had the location of the predecessor outpost I'd visited a couple years ago, and that was definitely bad. But he hadn't given it to Andre Damiani yet, or we wouldn't be here interrogating Molina. I wondered whether he'd given it to my mother, since he'd been in her pocket the last I'd heard. That possibility wasn't too pleasant to contemplate either, but of the two Damiani siblings, Patrice was the lesser evil at the moment. It took me a moment to notice the look on Calderon's face. It was as close as he came to insightful, which veered more toward cunning.
You didn't delete the data after you sent it, did you?
He asked Molina, and I felt my stomach twist with the knowledge that he was right. Molina's face went white, and he seemed too shocked to even resist the question.
No, I didn't.
Shit.
Where is it?
Calderon demanded, eyes flashing with an ambition that was almost hunger. I realized that my hand was creeping inside my jacket towards my holstered pistol. It was an idea. I could kill them both in 2 seconds and make sure that Andre Damiani didn't get the location of the predecessor technology. I forced my hand back to my side. It wouldn't do any good. Gregorian had the information already, and all I would accomplish by killing Calderon would be to boost the price he was going to ask for it. Not to mention I'd be tipping my hand and putting Sophia and Caesar in danger. I had to use my head.
It's in a drop-dead account on the public net,
Molina told him.
Jesus, I thought in disgust. What an amateur.
True, no one could tie it to him in a public access dead drop, but there was no way to secure that kind of account beyond a password. If he'd left it in a secure data depository, like the one on Hermes Moon, anyone who wanted it would need to take him there in person, and he'd only be allowed to access it in private with no one else present. It would give him a chance to escape. But this...
Tell me the account ID and the password,
Calderon instructed. It took longer this time, and he had to repeat the question twice. I thought for a minute that Molina was going to stroke out before he revealed the password. But in the end, the technology proved stronger than the man, and he blurted out the details with strings of drool hanging down his chin. Calderon made him say it twice more as he checked the account on the handheld display of his link. Finally, he seemed satisfied, and he shut the machine down, pulling the headphones and eye cups off of Molina. Calderon was whistling softly to himself as he began disassembling the hypnoprobe. I saw Bobby staring at me, an unreadable look on her face, like maybe she was waiting for me to do something. I had no idea what that something might be, so I just stood there and watched Molina sag against the seat restraints, his chin resting against his chest now that the framework of the probe had been removed.
"Clean that up for me, will you, Munroe?"
Calderon said absently, sealing the machinery back in its storage crate. "You want me to drop him back off in Overtown?" I asked. He turned and looked at me with something close to pity in his expression, as if he thought me an idiot to even have to ask.
"No, we can't chance the police or anyone else finding him and extracting the same intelligence. Kill him and dispose of the body."
I felt a flare of anger, and I wasn't sure if I was angrier at the offhanded way he'd ordered me to murder the man, or at the fact that he thought he could just order me to murder someone. "I'm not your fucking janitor, Calderon," I reminded him, a rumbling behind the words coming from the back of my throat. "You've got a gun. If you want him dead, do it yourself." He turned and squared off with me, his face a mask of stubborn pride. We'd had this sort of confrontation many times in the last couple years, and neither of us was of a mind to back down.
"You work for West, and so do I," he shot back, face turning a shade darker. "He made it my job to relay his instructions, and it's your job to carry those instructions out."
"Fine." I waved a hand demonstratively. "You get me instructions from Cowboy to kill this guy, and I'll pull the trigger."
"West is busy,"
he snapped. "So am I." I stepped around to the other side of the chair that held Molina and came within half a meter of Calderon, my hands balling up into fists. "I seem to remember beating the shit out of you once, Alberto, while I was drugged and unarmed and you had a gun."
"That wouldn't be a smart move for someone with so much to lose, Munroe."
If he'd thought that threatening my family was a way to calm me down, I was about to show him how mistaken he was. The crack, snap, hum of the laser discharging was loud and close, and filled the air with enough static electricity to make the hair on my neck stand on end. I spun around, my gun jumping into my hand, but Thiongo was already reholstering the pulse pistol. He'd only been a few steps away from Molina when he'd fired, and there wasn't much left of the DSI agent's head. A blackened and scorched crater about a centimeter deep on the wall behind him marked where the laser pulse had burned itself out. I stared at him in disbelief through the haze of smoke and steam, and he shrugged expressively.
"Someone was going to have to kill him," he said by way.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.